she was definitely telling the truth. It's almost like she said, well, tonight I am not going to die.
She could have left the room. She could have retreated. They were on opposite sides of the room, and she had the only weapon.
I didn't want to kill her. I just wanted to stop.
There's still a little bit of the Wild West in Texas. It's the good old boy mentality. There are still some pockets where they feel if the woman irritates the man, she needed hitting.
The abuse was always there. The walking on eggshells was always there.
Danny completely controlled Charlene, and she let him.
He was going to kill me that night. I wouldn't have made it out of the bedroom.
We have a saying in Texas, he just needed killing. And I thought that she probably did the world a favor by killing him.
Charlene Hill did not kill Danny Hill in self-defense. My name is Kelly Ziegler. I'm a former prosecutor. Rather than get a divorce and end an unhappy marriage, Charlene Hill's motivation was to take all the money. She wasn't going to split up the money with him. She wanted all of it.
I loved my husband very much. I loved my family. I had the dream.
If she truly loved him, let her tell that to his children who no longer have a father.
My dad was murdered. My best friend is dead.
I know my mother. She scares me. That lady scares me.
Her kids just threw her to the curb. They suddenly realized that with her put away, they were in control of the money.
Through her eyes, I could relive that night.
It just became really clear it wasn't self-defense.
He was coming at me. He was going to kill me. And unless you've been in that situation, you have no idea. It's like a grizzly bear getting ready to attack you.
Shootout at the Hills. Tonight's 48 Hours Mystery. The mystery continues in 90 seconds.
A dream, and this was Danny's and Maya's dream. We were looking at building our house right here and have the kids come up. Look forward to our grandbabies being up here.
Charlene Hill had lots of plans for the rest of her life, and none of them panned out. Everything changed on November 14th, 2006, when she shot her husband Danny to death.
I relived that night so many times. Do I wish I could change it all? Oh. It's just rough. It's rough knowing that this was our dream and he's gone.
From the beginning, Charlene's relationship with Danny was always complicated.
When we started, we more or less didn't have a pot to piss in or a window to throw it out of. And we had a 68 Chevy pickup truck, and life started.
They married in 1981. Charlene already had a little boy, Jeremy, from a previous marriage.
How did you see your life going when you married him?
That we'd have a
beautiful life together.
They settled down in a Houston suburb and soon had two more children, a son, Joby, and a daughter, Jamie.
I was his little girl. My dad and I were very close. He's been there through everything, throughout my whole life, pretty much.
The best memories I have of my youth are on the river with my family.
Charlene's first son, Jeremy.
It was perfect. It was so nice where people would stop on the river to look at our place. Dad swinging in the chair, my brother and sister skiing. It was awesome.
Danny was a good person.
Barbara Graham is Danny Hill's mother.
He was taking his children hunting and fishing, and it was every weekend. How many dads do you know do that?
Charlene and Danny were also working hard, building their landscaping and storage businesses together.
Danny, at times, was the most wonderful man to be around. Most loving and giving.
But that was just sometimes. Other times, Danny could suddenly turn violent. It had been that way since they met.
Had he slapped you?
No, he punched me.
Punched you?
Yeah.
Where would he punch you?
I mean, punch me in the face.
Charlene says Danny, who was a foot taller and 100 pounds heavier, over the years not only punched her, he kicked her and threatened to kill her. Charlene's calls to 911 and her trips to the emergency room are well documented. But she always refused to press charges.
I was afraid of what would happen if I did.
He was a very big, strong, intimidating man who feared no one.
Jennifer Hinch, a friend of Charlene's, first caught a glimpse of Danny's violent side when she noticed some strange holes in Danny and Charlene's bedroom door.
They were clean little round holes.
They were bullet holes.
And Danny said, yeah, that's where I shot and missed. Like, shot a gun? And he said, yeah, thought it was funny. He laughed.
So he was shooting at?
At Char through the door of the bedroom because she had locked him out.
Charlene knows it sounds strange, but like many abuse victims, she often blamed herself.
I felt a lot of it was my fault. It was what I said, it was what I didn't say, it was how I looked, how I didn't look.
Charlene says one time she did make plans to leave and Danny found out. And that's when she learned that trying to escape could be dangerous.
After knocking me around, he tied me to a chair. And poured gasoline on me. And stood there with the lighter and told me if I ever tried to leave, he'd kill me.
She says her husband didn't untie her until the next morning.
How could you possibly stay with a man who threatened to set you on fire and threatened your life?
Where do I go? I have limited resources. I have no family. At the time, I was afraid to leave.
Charlene did finally leave a few years later, after 10 years of marriage. She packed up the three kids and drove to California. But after several months, Charlene returned to Danny, voluntarily.
I missed him desperately while we were separated.
I mean, she loved Danny Hill. She had his children. You know, I mean, those vows said for better and worse, and she meant it, and she kept them.
I think they were each other's drug, that they couldn't live without the other and didn't want to live without the other.
Susan and Collis Watts were good friends of the Hills for years.
We never laughed as hard as we laughed when we were with them. They were a happy, loving couple when we were with them.
That might have been because Danny and Charlene finally went into counseling, and for several years, it looked like it was working. The family businesses were flourishing, and by now the Hills owned properties worth millions.
We were able to look forward to a life that was going to get better and better.
But those better times ended abruptly in August of 2003. Danny and Charlene were badly hurt in a motorcycle accident. Charlene's leg was shattered, but Danny suffered critical brain injuries, and he was never the same.
Changed him dramatically.
Did he still have that temper?
No.
No.
But Charlene claims Danny's temper was actually more frightening than ever, and that because of his brain injury, he didn't know when to stop.
It's like someone who goes into a rage.
And Charlene says she was never more afraid of her husband than she was on the evening of November 14th, 2006.
And what would he have done if he got you?
He'd have killed.
November 14th, 2006, the day Danny Hill died, began normally enough.
Saw him in the morning, right before he left to go to work. And that's the last time I'd seen my dad.
How was he that morning?
He was happy. He was in a good mood. Said, bye, baby girl. Love you. See you later. Gave my mom a kiss. Took off to work.
But according to Charlene, Danny's mood quickly soured in the privacy of the office the two shared.
That day in the office, I pushed one of his buttons. It just irritated him when I told him, you're not thinking.
That set him off a little bit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did he hit you?
He knocked me out of my chair.
It was the beginning of the end. Later that day, at a storage facility that Danny and Charlene had just sold to Danny's brother, there was another outburst. Danny still kept some of his stuff in one of the storage lockers. And when the manager asked him to clear it out, Danny got so mad that Charlene says his brother called to warn her.
So Danny was in a rage that he had gone off. He had threatened to kill his managers, wanted me to calm Danny down.
He wanted you to calm Danny down?
Yeah.
Because you knew how to do that sometimes, yeah.
She thought it would help Danny's mood if she tidied up the house and cooked his favorite meal.
He loved chicken and dumplings.
And you thought that would make him happy?
Oh, yeah. It would help him relax. When he got home, you know, if the house was clean, the laundry was done, make chicken and dumplings. It's just so much easier to relax in the evening.
But when Danny came home, he went to the bedroom, and he was in no mood for dinner.
When I came back into the bedroom, his rage centered on me. He was angry that I was trying to calm him down. His eyes were gone. He was gone. I'd seen the look in his eyes before, but I had never seen it like it did that night.
So she says she took her gun out of the nightstand and laid it on the bed as a warning.
Why not just back out of the room and get away?
Because of my physical condition, the injury to my leg, I knew I couldn't outrun him.
She says that Danny started coming at her, and she picked up the gun. Charlene fired 3 shots.
I just wanted to stop him.
When the paramedics arrived, 49-year-old Danny Hill managed to tell them, with his dying breath, that his own wife had shot him. Charlene was arrested that night and charged with murder.
When she was indicted, I was really kind of surprised. I thought it was self-defense.
As soon as she heard about it, Bev Carter, publisher of the Fort Bend Star, thought this was one Texas tale that had to be told.
Here was a woman that had been abused for years. She had this big, huge husband that was loud and obnoxious. He had beaten her up so many times, somebody had to stop him. I'm telling you, Richard, he needed killing.
But not everyone saw it Bev Carter's way. There were doubters, including Charlene's own children.
I know my mother, and I know what she is about, and yeah.
The stretching of the truth and the elaboration of truth it's happened a lot.
Jamie and Jeremy Hill know their father was abusive, but they claim their mother was often the instigator.
My mom would take after him with knives and stuff like that.
You've seen her go after him with a knife more than once?
Yes, sir. He would go into the room, you know, after they had a fight or whatnot, and my mother would never let it just lie, you know? She would take off to the room. Only one of us is going to come out.
Did you know how to push his buttons? I mean, would you fight back sometimes?
Oh, yeah. You know, we've been together a long time. We knew each other's dance, moves.
But there's more incriminating evidence against Charlene. A gun she bought just weeks before she shot Danny.
It's easy for somebody to assume that that's when you started planning or thinking about.
No, Danny had told Jeremy and Joby to make sure Mom gets a gun.
Danny had told your sons to make sure you got a gun?
Yeah, and Jeremy's the one who took me down to purchase the gun.
Charlene claims Danny wanted her to have the gun for her protection at their new ranch.
He wanted me to have the weapons because he was traveling. You're out there in the middle of nowhere.
But Jeremy says his mother told him she also needed it for another reason.
She didn't feel safe around my dad.
Did you believe that your mother needed that gun to protect her from your father?
No. I didn't believe that, no.
And Charlene's kids say right after she made bail, their mother made a startling admission to them about exactly what happened in the bedroom just before she pulled the trigger.
She said that he wasn't coming at her, he didn't put his hands on her.
That he was not coming at
yes.
her?
Yes.
That he did not put his hands on
yes.
her?
Yes.
At that moment, what happened to you?
I felt sick to my stomach. After that was said, my brother and I knew for sure that this was murder.
Murder.
All right.
It is the charge Charlene Hill is now facing. It was hard to imagine things getting any worse for Charlene Hill. She was facing life in prison for murdering her husband, and even her children had turned against her.
It hurts that they hate me so much. You know, I wished I would let Danny kill me.
But then, just months before her trial, her family suffered another staggering loss. Her son, Joby, committed suicide on the eve of his 27th birthday.
The hate that me and my brother carried for so long finally took over my brother.
Jeremy and Jamie already believe their mother murdered their father. Now they blame her for their brother Joby's death as well.
Did he talk to you about that in his last days? Or?
What else are we gonna talk about except for, everything that's going on? And you know, we tried to help each other to deal with it. You know, we were both filled with hate and anger and everything else that you could feel.
Joby left behind a handwritten suicide note. He wrote, "I lost who I used to be due to capital murder case, lawyers. It is a sick system."
Just a beautiful young man. And he was my baby.
And he was supposed to be a witness for the prosecution.
He absolutely dreaded it.
I wished I could have known to reach out. I wish I would have done anything.
Now, a lonely Charlene Hill must fight for her life in court. She's hired prominent defense attorney George Parnum.
What does the jury have to believe in order to let her walk out of the courthouse a free woman?
She shot him to stop him from assaulting her, to stop him from killing her. All right? And that's the ultimate issue.
This was not self-defense.
Former prosecutor Kelly Siegler doesn't buy Parnum's argument. She's observing this case for her own reasons. More about that a little later.
She pulled out the gun, she put it in the room with him, she manipulated the whole situation and then tried to orchestrate this whole defense of I was in fear for my life. It was a big crock.
At this time, the court calls cause number 45962, the state of Texas versus Charlene Roberta Hill.
And as Charlene's murder trial begins, the prosecution sets out to prove that she not only wanted Danny dead, she even tried to get someone else to do her dirty work.
Did Charlene Hill ever offer you money to kill Danny Hill?
Yes.
Clint Walker, a man with a long rap sheet, once dated Charlene's daughter, Jamie.
How much did she offer you?
$5,000.
She looked at Clint and she said, how can we take care of this? She said, $5,000? She said, if I gave you $5,000, would you take care of this?
But was there any question in your mind about what take care of your dad meant?
Coming from her, no. For $5,000, would somebody murder my father?
That conversation allegedly took place in 2003, shortly after that near-fatal motorcycle crash.
Rather than get a divorce and end an unhappy marriage, Charlene Hill's motivation was to be rid of a husband that had become a burden to her and to take all the money.
Siegler believes money, and lots of it, was the real motive then and 3 years later when Charlene finally pulled the trigger herself.
Just a month before it happened, she also moved $1 million into an account in her name, but not his. I mean, just use your common sense. How can that happen?
Charlene denies that she ever asked Clint Walker to kill her husband or that she was scheming to control the couple's assets.
Did you transfer the $1 million from the business account to an account with just your name on it?
No, I did not. I transferred the $1 million from our corporate account into a money market account.
So if he wanted any of that money, he could have gotten it?
100%.
Charlene's lawyers need to prove it was fear, not the family fortune, that made her shoot Danny. And they have witnesses who will describe, in sometimes horrifying detail, the years of abuse Charlene endured.
He had thrown her either on the bed or on the other side of the bed.
His rage was greater than they had anticipated.
When I got to the door and I looked back, he had thrown her across the room.
Susan Watts says the incident she witnessed in the Hills' office was so frightening that neither she nor her husband ever spoke to Charlene and Danny again.
I didn't know if I should call the police, and I went back to the office when she came running in. And she had a big footprint on the front of her white top.
A footprint?
A footprint. And she came in and she said, hide me, just hide me, I'll be okay.
It was April 1st, 1998. Hospital records show Jeremy accompanied his mother to the ER. She had a fractured rib.
I went through 6 months of nightmares after witnessing all that, and I was disappointed to hear that Charlene had gone back to him a few days after the incident.
In spite of that incident and others, Jeremy Hill is still prepared to take the stand against his own mother.
Would you say that your parents had a volatile relationship?
Yes, sir.
He blames Charlene.
He was provoked. He was pushed to the point of where he felt he had to respond that way.
And he tells the court the violence stopped after the motorcycle accident.
He became a big pussycat, if you will.
Prosecutor questions Jeremy about that conversation that turned Charlene's own children against her.
What did she say?
She said that he was not coming at her, that he did not have a gun, that he had not hit her, and that he was standing on the other side of the room.
Watching her firstborn testify against her is more than Charlene can bear. But now the defense is ready to confront Jeremy about why he has turned against his mother. And attorney George Parnum believes the motive is money.
Your mother did not have an inkling, an iota, that you had gone through $1 million that day.
Jeremy Hill says he has struggled with his decision to testify against his mother, Charlene, at her murder trial.
I told her I couldn't look at her.
But this is the woman who raised you.
Yeah.
This
That's
is
what's
your mother.
So hard. That's what's so hard about this whole situation.
It's about to get even harder.
I mean, these are your words, aren't they, sir?
Yes, sir.
His mother's lawyer, George Parnham, gets Jeremy to grudgingly admit that his father even beat him.
It was a time when you were in the fifth grade, when your father came into your bedroom and beat you so severely for no reason that he knocked you out.
He punched me once and knocked me out, yes, sir.
But there's more. A startling glimpse into the violence that, at times, gripped the Hill family.
Do you remember a time when you and Joby, your brother, determined that you were going to kill your dad? You were going to get a gun and you were going to shoot him.
Yes, sir.
Jeremy admits that years earlier he had hatched a plan to kill his father because of the violence.
And it's because he was abusing your mother, right?
They had had an incident, yes, sir.
Yeah.
So why has he turned against his mother?
Do you have any ulterior motive for turning against your mother in this case?
No. No, my dad was murdered. My kids will never know their pawpaw, except through pictures. It's family destroyed.
But Charlene's attorney says Jeremy's real motive has nothing to do with family.
I forecast long ago the worm will turn. Money is a very powerful issue.
In fact, the Hills are in a nasty fight over Danny's estate worth at least $2 million. Jeremy, Jamie, and Danny's mother have already filed a wrongful death lawsuit against Charlene.
Charlene Hill decided to kill Danny Hill, and she did that intentionally, and she did that knowingly.
Former prosecutors Kelly Siegler and Dean Blumrosen are watching this trial so closely because they now represent the kids and Danny's mother in that lawsuit.
They believe in all their heart that Charlene Hill committed this act because she wanted the money.
But Charlene's attorney says she's not the one after the money. George Parnham gets Jeremy to admit that when his mother transferred $1 million to him for safekeeping, he withdrew it and split it with his siblings to pay off debts.
Your mother did not have an inkling, an iota, that you had gone through $1 million that day.
Correct.
This was a greedy, out of control, dysfunctional group of kids.
Journalist Bev Carter isn't shy when she sizes up the defense's latest argument.
Her kids just threw her to the curb. They suddenly realized that with her put away, they were in control of the money.
The defense will call Charlene Hill.
Now Charlene has decided to take a chance few murder defendants ever do. She's taking the stand in her own defense.
Were you ever struck?
Yes, sir.
Were you ever hospitalized?
Yes, sir.
She painfully recounts years of violence.
Danny was grabbing me by the throat and had me on the ground, and this time he threw my head through a window.
Let's take a moment for you.
Then her lawyer asked her about the night she shot her husband.
Did he threaten to kill you?
He got very angry at me because I kept trying to calm him down.
What'd you do?
I pulled the clock out of the dresser and I laid it on the bed. And I kind of stood back and I told Danny, don't come near me. We're not going to go there.
Did Danny say anything to you when he saw the gun on the bed?
He laughed at me. And then he said, we're going to do a shootout. I'm getting my gun and I'm going to shoot you. You better shoot me.
Charlene tells the court Danny kept coming towards her. And then the admission, as simple as it is chilling.
I shot my husband.
You shot him?
Now a fragile Charlene Hill faces prosecutor Jill Stotts, who quickly zeroes in on the moments before Charlene shot her husband.
Is that something that normally would calm Danny down, is showing him that you have a gun? It really wasn't to calm him down. It was to show that you had the upper hand, correct?
No, it was to tell him to back off.
Well, telling him to back off is not the same as calming him down.
For 2 days, the prosecutor won't let up.
At that point, when you saw the change in his eyes, did you think that maybe you should leave the room?
At that time period, I know I was trapped.
At that point, could you have picked up that weapon, even if you're pointing it at him, and walked out the door?
No, ma'am.
Why is that?
Because I believed I was in danger.
Danger of what? You have the gun.
My husband was a lethal weapon without a gun.
It is the heart of the case against Charlene Hill. Did she have to shoot Danny, or could she simply have left the room?
You couldn't outrun him.
Oh, God, no. I would have maybe gotten one step past the bedroom door and he'd have had me. He's 6'5". He'd have had me in two steps.
And what would he have done if he got you?
He'd have killed me.
After a grueling cross-examination, Charlene is showing the strain.
All I knew, he was coming at me, he was going to kill me, and unless you've been in that situation, you have no idea. It's like a grizzly bear getting ready to attack you.
All right.
As the trial draws to a close, defense attorney Dee McWilliams is satisfied that Charlene stuck to her story and never wavered.
I don't think she could have come across as more credible. This is such a basic self-defense case.
Of course, that's the jury's call. And while nobody knows it yet, another emotional drama is about to begin inside the jury room.
It just couldn't be any simpler. This was her life or his, period.
As the case against Charlene Hill goes to the jury,
you have your instructions and we await your verdict.
Her defense attorneys are not the only ones who expect a quick acquittal.
And I thought it was going to take them a very short amount of time to do that because it was so obvious that she was scared for her life.
And it's pretty much the way it is.
Sylvia Lassie is one of the jurors.
When the prosecutor asked her a question, why didn't she not retreat? She said, you don't know my husband.
He was coming at me and all I knew
He was going to kill me. I kind of felt that she was going to die that night.
Other jurors, Quentin, Karen, and Levon, who did not want their last names used, were also convinced that Charlene Hill endured years of brutality.
You think she was afraid for her life?
Mentally, yes. She thought that he was going to come at her.
I did believe her testimony. I found it extremely painful to listen to.
But these jurors surprised everyone. Early on, during a break, bailiff Mary Charles noticed one of them was in distress.
And I could tell that she was holding her stomach and she looked nervous. And she was pacing back and forth. She says, they're not going to make me change my mind. They're not going to make me change my mind.
Had a juror ever talked to you about stuff like that before?
Never.
It was Sylvia Lassie, and the deliberations were quickly deteriorating.
What was it like in that room?
Hostile.
Hostile?
Very hostile. Then I kind of turned around like this so I wouldn't see them looking at me.
Inside the jury room, the vote was 11-1, guilty. With Sylvia, the lone holdout. 11 jurors believe Charlene Hill could have run out of the room. And they looked at the law, which said she could only shoot to kill if it was, quote, immediately necessary.
If he's across the room, he's turned away from her, is that immediate danger?
These jurors felt the bloodstains told the story, proving that Danny was still at the other side of the room when he was shot by his wife.
You had the gun. You were by the door. Walk out.
It's that simple.
It's that simple.
Sylvia says she tried to persuade the others that Charlene could not outrun her husband because of her leg injury.
What are you all talking about? How can she retreat? Can't you see Charlene was doing this here?
Sylvia would not back down, and things got so heated, it began to look like there would be no verdict.
What did they say to you?
I am sick and tired of you. I'm sick and tired of you up in here with all these different scenarios. I said, but I believe with all my heart that she is not guilty.
Her mind was made up when she went in there and she wasn't willing to listen.
Well, tell me this, Sylvia. Is it okay with you that this becomes a mistrial?
She would just say, I feel this way and I'm not changing it. And I don't care about the evidence.
I said, wait a minute. If it becomes a mistrial, it's because you all says she's guilty.
And I felt that that was an injustice.
Nobody budged. And after 2 days of deliberations, Judge James Shoemake had no choice.
I'm going to grant the motion for mistrial made by the defense.
He declared a mistrial.
We were shocked. We were absolutely shocked. Everybody there, the bailiffs, everybody, honestly thought that she would be found not guilty.
Now, 53-year-old Charlene Hill will face another trial, another jury, and another possibility of life in prison.
It's like living in a nightmare that's never going to be over.
As she waits for the coming trial, Charlene's making plans for the ranch.
This is the meadow that I'm putting up crosses for Danny and for Joby.
She wants to build a memorial to her son Joby and even her late husband.
I need a place to be able to come and sit down and just talk to him.
Now, more than anything else, Charlene wants to be reunited with Jeremy and Jamie. They have refused to see their mother for more than 3 years.
I love my children very much. They're my heart.
Do you love her at all anymore?
There's a love. You know, there comes to a point where you gotta let the hate go and learn forgiveness. But forgiveness is hard, because you can't forget.
Nobody wins in this kind of case in the end. Danny's dead. Charlene still loves him. She's not speaking to her children. They're not speaking to her. It's a sad situation.
It's taken me a long time to realize that it's okay that I'm alive. And I believe that God's not done with me yet.
On a date with my Zach. A white truck pulled up. That's when the man pulled out a gun. He aimed at us and let every single bullet out of his gun.